internationally known, but I'm known across a microphone because I get stupid.
You mean Periscopers, thank you for watching on Periscope. We are live on UVMRadio.com channel 2. You're watching the
Deuce.
Score. That was fun.
That was when did that song come out? Because that was. Was I jamming that in high school? What was I? When was I jamming that?
I probably wasn't born when that song came out.
Oh, boy. Okay. Hey, age myself.
Oh, whatever, whatever. And I decided, you know, it takes two. God, we love Steph. We miss you, but...
Bam!
Takes two.
The deuce, the pair.
You're watching The Morning Score, your top of day fix for professional and college sports and for gaming. I'm Erica Renee Davis. You can find me on Snapchat, Periscope, Twitter, and Instagram, and YouTube at Erica Renee D.
All over the board.
Yep.
You can find me on Twitter at Trevor Anthony. And you know what? I'm starting to Vine a lot.
Okay.
So hit me up at Vine at Trevor Anthony. Okay. I've got my hashtag Trevor Travel Tips.
Oh, I like that. Because you do travel a lot.
I travel a lot and I try to make them fun and goofy.
Okay.
Yeah, so check them out.
Hashtag Trevor's Travel Tips.
Yep.
Traverse or just Trevor?
Yeah, Trevor's.
Trevor's Travel. Okay. Okay.
TTT.
And as always, follow The Morning Score on Instagram at The Morning Score Show. Follow us on Twitter at The Morning Score. Mm-hmm. Also, use the hashtag TMS Talk to join us in the conversation either right now while we're filming or throughout the week. And you can always download this episode on, you know, I'm looking at myself versus looking at the camera. I'm sure you're like,
damn, I look good this morning.
You can always download this episode on iTunes, on Stitcher, on TuneIn as well. So download, go to ubnradio.com. You can download from ubnradio.com, I think. Can't you do that, Trevor? I mean, Jarvis? Okay. And before we start, I have to have a little surprise for my special Valentine.
Oh!
For Jarvis. Who gets the basketball? Jarvis, do you even like basketball? Okay, good.
All right, hoops.
So Jarvis gets the basketball Valentine. And Trevor gets the baseball Valentine.
Oh, nice. Snap.
Happy, I'm going to throw this to Jarvis.
Thank you.
It. Let's see. Whoa.
Yay, oh!
Got it. Okay, so we're going to start off the show with the sizzle, the top of the show, the most relevant newsworthy topics. Ronda Rousey's in the news. Ronda Rousey's in the news. She admitted to Ellen DeGeneres yesterday that she contemplated suicide after she lost to Holly Holm in UFC 193 last November. She said that in the medical room, she thought to herself, since I lost, what am I anymore if I'm not this? I need to know, what do you think, Trevor, or how does this admission you impact what you view Ronda or how you view Ronda as a competitor?
I mean, here's my thing, and I never want to take suicide or contemplating suicide lightly at all.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, this is a fighter who'd never been beat. She got beat. She was feeling like absolute shit. Plus, yeah. She's beat up, so she's physically and mentally just drained. And I'm sure I want to say that everybody in our lives, and we don't talk about it because people think you're crazy or
mm-hmm. what.
But you've she didn't cut herself. She didn't get a gun. She didn't fill up the bathtub. I mean, it was a thought that went in her head and then she let it go. So I understand her being beaten down and thinking about it. But I think this story has just blown up into epic proportions.
I agree with you on that.
And it's like it's all been in there, but she never actually did anything to really scare anybody. But now she's got all the movie coming out.
Yep.
It was just the perfect time to say this on the Ellen Show and to garner sympathy for her.
I agree.
After people were kind of hating on her.
And so, and I like what you said about her movie. Is it Roadhouse?
The Roadhouse
remake coming out. This is not going to be a popular angle to explore, but I wonder if she decided to make that admission on Ellen because, as you said, people kind of hate her right now. And because the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue was just released 2 days ago, and because she has a movie to promote. Again, I'm not taking suicide lightly by any means. I mean,
absolutely
if
not.
She was really in that moment feeling suicidal, that is something that is serious and that she should get continued help for in the event that she has another low point in her life. But I am a firm believer working in the entertainment industry that every single thing that any high profile celebrity or athlete goes through is very carefully choreographed by their team. And I'm not saying that her PR people said, Ronda, tell Ellen that you were suicidal, but I'm not saying that they didn't.
Right. And also, it's like Ellen is so cool and she seems like she's she's one of us and blah, blah, blah. And you sit on her couch and it's easy to kind of spill some thoughts. So when you say, oh, I contemplated suicide, anytime anybody hears suicide, it's mm-hmm. like, what? Well, it's like, it's like suicide. But I've sat in a bar after a shitty moment, sipping on a bourbon, being like, why is this, is it worth going on, blah, blah, blah. But never in a million years will I actually ever do that. And I highly doubt Rhonda. And I don't know, so I can't speak for her.
Well, her dad did commit suicide when she was 8. So maybe she's been living with those demons. So versus someone who has not had suicide be a part of their personal life. Maybe that's a tragedy that could affect her in a way that it wouldn't affect you or me.
Yeah, no, and you're absolutely right. That's, you know, with her dad, it does make it a little bit more serious. It just seems... the timing of everything mm-hmm. seems a little weird. And it's, you know, in our day of social media, everything just gets blown out of proportion. I think even to the point where if this isn't truly deep and dark with Rhonda, she might even get sick of having to answer all these questions now because she may have opened a wormhole.
I agree.
And she's like, oh God, why did I even say anything?
I agree with that. And I do want to make a comment. A lot of analysts and just, you know, social commentators are saying that she's a sore loser and she needs to learn how to lose, and that her being suicidal is just an after effect of her not knowing how to lose gracefully. And I want to say this. When you are a Cam Newton, a Floyd Mayweather, a Ronda Rousey, your whole entire image is built on the premise that you are immortal. And everything that you do has to go hand in hand with that brand of being unbeatable. So whether it's your social media, whether it's your interviews, whether it's how you walk into the ring, whether it's how you speak to people, it's all about being a gladiator. So when that one thing happens to you and shows that you actually are vulnerable, it takes a toll on you. And I just want people to understand that. I think there's a such thing as being a sore loser. But I think there's also the stress of being such a highly lauded public figure that most people will never understand. Like, she's going through something that most of us will never understand.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. Everything... I mean, cameras are on her constantly.
You think she's a sore loser, I can tell.
Well, I mean, I've never heard her say anything shitty about Holly Holm.
Okay.
You know, and to me, that would be a real sore loser. Like, I've heard that, you know, she got hit, mm-hmm. and it was the first time she'd really been hit that hard, and it kind of knocked her out of the whole fight. But she never, I personally haven't heard her say, you know, I wasn't ready, I wasn't prepared, Holly Holm was cheap. Like, she's never said anything bad, so... I think she's a bad loser. I don't know if she's a sore loser because she hasn't come up with excuses or cried about it or just walked out of a press conference.
Like, almost said Kanye, like Cam Newton.
I mean, it's a weird thing because, you know, just saying with Cam, everybody's mm-hmm. like, oh, well, when was the last time you lost a big game? You were probably pissed. I'm like, hell yeah, I was pissed. I'm a competitive bastard and I've never been to that level of a Super Bowl or a UFC championship, so I can only imagine how bad it is to lose that. And I can see in your mind having those thoughts of like, it's over, I should just end it. Mm. But I think that's just a competitor in you. I don't know if, and once again, I don't want to speak for her because it is a serious matter,
but
I just think it's something that went in her head and then it was gone.
How differently would we react if that had been a Floyd or another UFC fighter who was a man crying on Jimmy Kimmel's couch, let's say, and saying, oh, I was suicidal, but you're a man? How would we be reacting as a society right now?
Man, that's tough. Well, I think half of society would beat the living hell out of the guy. Being like, who is this baby crying on the couch? What the hell?
Isn't that sad?
But then another half might be like, he's so vulnerable.
Oh, yeah.
I love this man.
Let's put him on The Bachelor.
But yeah, right? That's the thing. I think 75% of the public would be crucifying him.
Yeah.
And then like producers and stuff like that would be like, let's use this.
Okay. Well, you know, speaking of, I guess, capitalizing on your fame or infamy for Ronda Rousey, Sports Illustrated decided to make her one of their most recent swimsuit issue cover models. Now, in the 52-year history of Swimsuit Illustrated, in the 52-year history of Sports Illustrated, look, this coffee is not doing the trick.
I was just going to let it go.
not doing the trick. In the 52-year history of Sports Illustrated's swimsuit issue, there have never been three different models on the same issue on three different covers. So the three models were Ashley Graham, who is considered plus size. She's a size 16 model. Then you have, what's the other girl's name? Is it Haley?
Haley
Clausen. You know, typical, look at you, Megan. Look at you with those eyebrows. Okay, we're going, I know, okay.
Haley.
I'm ready to talk about this with you. Haley, typical, cute, blonde, thin, tall, and then Ronda Rousey. Sports Illustrated describes women as being sexy, beautiful, and smart. What are your thoughts, Trevor, on how Sports Illustrated decided to honor three different kinds of beauty on this year's swimsuit issue cover?
Well, I think it was brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, for a couple reasons. I mean, one thing that I read in an article I believe you sent to me is that the Sports Illustrated folks were talking about how, you know, sexy and beauty comes in all different shapes and sizes, and everybody sees it differently. And it just brings me back to being at, I'm going to tell a story.
Okay.
Being at bars with my buddies who weren't the most confident guys in the world. And I would tell them, I'd be like, dude, don't worry about it. Just go up and talk to these women because everybody has different tastes.
That's true.
I'm like, you and I standing next to each other, we could have 10 girls. Five of them will like you. Well, maybe seven. Or three will like you. Seven will like me. You know, maybe 80, 20. But just kidding. But
it's like totally 50-50. Serious.
I'm like, it could be. It's like 50-50. You don't know. Because some of the hottest chicks in the world are walking around with like goofball looking dudes.
True.
Who are probably rich. But
like The Weeknd, the singer The Weeknd is dating what, Gigi Hadid, whatever her name is. Or he was dating her.
It's people like different things. Like, I know plenty of guys who like big girls.
Okay.
I don't like big girls. I like Haley from the swimsuit issue.
Okay.
I'm going to buy a swimsuit issue with a bunch of Haleys.
Okay.
Not a bunch of Ronda Rouseys or the other girl.
Okay.
I mean, but that's just
me. That's your personal preference.
That's my personal preference. That's how I see beauty. And then other people might be like, damn, look at that. What was her name? The 16.
Ashley Graham.
They might love her.
They might.
And nobody has, I mean, Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition has gone way down. So what a brilliant way to bring it back up and get people talking about
it. I agree with that. And with the so MJ Days, the assistant managing editor of Sports Illustrated swimsuit issues, she said that one of her long-term objectives has been to promote inclusiveness and to show all kinds of beauty. And this particularly resonated with me because in the industry that you and I work in, like, we're sports hosts, we're on-air personalities, and you never, and this is a personal thing, you never see a dark-skinned woman in studio as a sports host, ever. Like, you can look at Fox Sports 1, you can look at ESPN, you can look all across the board, and you will not find a dark-skinned woman in studio as a host. They'll put you on the sideline, they'll have you doing, like, the little grunt work here and there, but never in studio. And so for me to look at Ashley Graham to represent a different kind of beauty, although it's not about skin color, it's about her size and her weight, I'm like, Sports Illustrated, I applaud you for stepping out on a limb and embracing a different kind of beauty that for me in my industry, I have not at this point been given that opportunity because people are afraid to take risks. People are afraid, the suits are afraid to put someone in place when it hasn't been done before, no matter how qualified you are, no matter, you know, how talented you are, suits are afraid to take a risk. And Sports Illustrated took a risk, and I'm very proud of them for doing that.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I'll be honest. The first time I saw it, I was like, what? I mean, where's the Elle McPhersons? And but then, you know, that's after, like, the frat boy in me. But then when I really sat down and thought about it, I was like, this is great because when you do watch people in studio or on the red carpet or the Grammys or the Oscars or whatever, all I ever want to do is have a buffet at the end of the line and start force feeding some of these actresses and hosts and stuff. It's like, eat some food.
Don't feed the models, Trevor. You haven't learned yet. Don't feed the models.
I mean, holy crap. It kills me. And I know the whole camera thing and it adds 10 pounds.
It does.
And it does. It truly does.
But TV timeout, though. TV timeout. Now, everyone has their personal preference. I don't want anyone out there to think that we are body shaming thin people, you know, either. I mean, no, we're being funny, but sometimes super thin people who can't help that they're thin get offended. They say, oh, I can't help that I'm thin. I have a thyroid problem, or you don't know what I'm dealing with. So it's not about us picking at people who are excessively thin. It's just about saying what we like, what we don't like.
Well, yeah, but at the same time, I mean, hey, some people can't help if they're big. Some people can't help if they're be skinny. But in the entertainment industry, I'm going to go out on a limb and say 90% of those, mainly women,
yeah,
practically starve themselves.
Yeah, like, I'm just going to have coffee today because, you know, you know, I got to make sure these cheekbones come through.
So I'm saying, kudos to Sports Illustrated, mm-hmm, for saying, hey, all young girls out there, you don't have to be crazy thin,
yeah,
to be beautiful. You can have a little junk in your trunk, be a little big boned, whatever, yeah, and you can still be beautiful. So I appreciate that.
I appreciate it. My only concern is this. I like that on Ashley Graham's Instagram,
hey-o,
you can see her working out and lifting weights. And my only issue, I can't say issue, but I just want people to know that if you're gonna be bigger, still try to live a healthy lifestyle. Oh. Like, don't be one of those people who's like, oh, I'm going to eat pork chops and dressing every single day and macaroni and loaded mashed potatoes without working out and trying to live healthy. Because I think more recent studies do show that you can have a little bit more body fat and still be technically healthy. So the whole slim, thick revolution, that's all cute, but make sure you're still working out, getting your cardio in, lifting weights. Okay.
Well, and just go off that. I mean, they were also smart, like with Rhonda, obviously, she's a workout freak.
Oh, yeah, we didn't even talk about her.
She's a little bigger.
Yeah.
And then Ashley, you know, even though she's bigger boned, you can still see
some definition
that there's some athleticism in there, or she works, she exercises.
She does.
Still live a healthy lifestyle. There are no 400-pounders on the swimsuit issue.
Yeah.
And for a good reason, because then that's, if you get to that point, it's pretty much, I'm just eating Burger King and washing it down with McDonald's.
No offense to Burger King, McDonald's, especially if you want to sponsor us.
That's right. I actually really enjoy your food.
Okay, before we go into the NBA trade deadline talk, I want you to rank them, number 1 to 3. Or I guess your least, I don't know, least favorite to most favorite for the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue models.
Oh, ever?
No, just these three.
Well, I mean, I'm going Haley number one.
Okay.
I mean, that's just my kind of gal.
Okay.
You know, she looks pretty good on that.
Yeah.
And I'm actually going to go with Ashley.
Okay.
Because, I don't know, there's, Ronda Rousey is awesome, but she's just not feminine enough for me.
Okay, that's fine.
So, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's just my taste.
That's your taste. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to go Ashley because I think she has the most beautiful face of the
three. She does have a really pretty
face. She has a very pretty face. Yeah. And then also I like her because she is, she's a business owner.
Oh.
And my thing is, to me in the modeling world, if you're going to be a model, have a side hustle, be educated, you know, have a degree, have your master's, have a business. Don't just be a model. And Ashley has those things. And then Haley, because she's cute, you know, she's a cute girl. And then Rhonda, because like you said, like, she's just not my type either. Hashtag TMS talk. Join the conversation on Twitter.
I've said before on this show, if a woman could kick my ass, I'm probably not going to be very attracted to her.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. Rhonda, that's you. Sorry. Trevor's out. Trevor's out. NBA trade deadline's Thursday, 3 o'clock p.m. Eastern time. The rumors are more rampant than ever. Here are a few of them. Clippers, are they trying to get rid of Blake Griffin? Absolutely not. I got the inside scoop. Cavaliers want to part ways with Kevin Love. Dwight Howard out at Houston. The Heat and the Rockets are reportedly discussing a trade with Hassan Whiteside and Dwight Howard. Lakers possibly giving up D'Angelo Russell and Hibbert to get Carmelo. I mean, it's just kind of all over the place right now. My personal beef with this is with the Clippers rumor. About 2 weeks ago, obviously, about 2 weeks ago, they were saying, oh, Clippers are trying to get rid of Blake to send him to Denver. I'm like, why in the hell would we get rid of Blake to send him to Denver for what? Like, I can't even think of any one or two or three scenarios that could happen right now in the middle of the season where the Clippers could get better, good enough to beat the Warriors in a 7-game series by letting go of Blake. I think this is just the most asinine, baseless rumor in the entire trade deadline story. Of course, I have personal interest in it because it's my team.
Right.
And I do feel like where there's smoke, there's fire. So maybe there have been some rumors floating around. Maybe because the Clippers are 18-5 without Blake versus barely being .500 when he was healthy. Maybe that's why the rumors have started. But at any rate, Blake's not going anywhere. I'm done.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, teams could be calling the Clippers and asking about Blake, mm-hmm. and what team doesn't want Blake Griffin on their squad? So, you know, a reporter sniffs out that, oh my God, they're taking calls. Of course, they're going to take calls. I mean, they're not dumb, but I don't think they're shopping him.
No.
For any reason. He is the franchise. The thing with the Clippers, and don't kill me.
Go ahead and make me get pissed off, Trevor.
What are they going to do? I mean, this team, it has seemed like they have been on the cusp for like 5 years.
Oh, we have been. And the thing is, Trevor, last year would have been the year to make a statement. Now, Golden State is so good that no one can beat them, not even the Spurs, not even whoever comes out of the East, the Cavaliers. So I think that, yes, we have squandered opportunities in the past couple of years to get out of the second round. But now, I don't care what team you are, you're not going to beat Golden State. So this year, I'm just going to take it as a loss, count it as a loss, because there's nothing that you can do to beat Golden State. So that's all I got to say.
Now, you never know. There could be some injuries. But then you have to face the Spurs that are so much better than they were last year.
I'm not worried about the Spurs.
But here's the thing with this trade deadline.
Yes.
I just want to see something spicy. I want to see something gigantic. I mean, I don't want Charlotte, Memphis, and Miami just had a trade.
Oh,
and it's like, whatever. Okay, I get it. These teams are making themselves better. And obviously that's going to happen. But I want to see guys like, you know, well, not Blake.
Not Blake.
But I would love to see like a Melo or a Kevin Love.
Or a Kevin Durant.
Or a Durant. Or who else did I have on? I want to see those big. I mean, everybody's talking about Dwight Howard and whatever. That guy is just a cancer for any team that he goes to. I mean, what the hell happened to the Rockets?
And
it's mind-blowing.
Jeff Van Gundy made a really good point on Mike and Mike this morning. He was saying that Dwight Howard's upward trajectory could have been better had he stayed in Orlando and not gone from the Lakers and now to Houston. And I believe that he had so much potential. I think we saw so much more potential in him when he was with the Magics. And then for me, I think it's just kind of gone downhill. And he's had the health issues. And not only health issues, I question his heart. I question whether or not he is a hard ass about being the best at his position and about being the best player that he can be on a team to help them get to the next level. I don't know if that's his preoccupation.
There is no reason why that guy shouldn't have been the most dominant center like the last 5 years. I mean, the guy is built like a brick shit house and he's a monster. And why has he been so I mean, his numbers are okay here and there, but the teams that he goes to, and I agree with Van Gundy, that guy could have stayed in Orlando and been their guy.
Been their
had
guy.
Had a statue of Dwight Howard outside of their, you know, outside of their stadium,
or
their arena.
Or he could have just stood outside their arena because he himself looks like a
statue.
Right,
exactly. And then he goes to the Lakers and he hates it, and then he goes to Houston and they just fold. I don't know. That guy drives me crazy, but there are some teams that just need to get blown up.
Like who?
And I'm so...
The Knicks? The Bulls?
The Bulls.
The Bulls.
The Bulls are one, and it breaks my heart because they had a shot the past couple years. Derrick Rose getting hurt. That just kind of killed them. They get rid of Tom Thibodeau.
Ugh.
Now they're just old and broken, and it's just time to put some dynamite under there and blow it up. Get rid of Gasol. Get rid of these guys that you can get like
something
young and build around Jimmy Butler.
Okay.
I mean, that's in my opinion, that's what they need to do. So I hope they make moves. Another team that's crazy, because you think about it, the Bulls had a shot for the Eastern Championship.
Yeah.
They should have. I mean, they could have easily beat that Cavs team. They blew so many games in that series.
They did. That was very disappointing.
It was so disappointing. And that was just the end of it. It was just like, okay, this team, they're kind of like the Clippers. Like, they had this nucleus, and they just never got over the hump. But also the Hawks. The Hawks.
Oh, the Al Horford.
About this time last year, we were talking about, hey, are the Hawks for real?
We did. We did.
And now you just blow up that team.
Well, but the Hawks right now are fourth in the East, and I don't know. I mean, I think what's happening in the East is the same thing that's happening in the West. The Cavaliers are so head and shoulders above all the other teams in the East that you look at everyone else underneath them and you think, oh, well, they don't have a chance. Even though the Hawks are fourth in the East, they don't have a chance. And you look at the West, you know, the Warriors are so much better than everybody else, except for the Spurs, that you start looking at the Clippers, like, what are you going to do? You look at the Rockets, what are you going to do? You look at the Mavs, like, what are you going to do? And it's like these teams underneath the one seeds are not horrible. It's just that they're so much better than everyone else. You almost want the GMs to make moves just to see if they can get as good as the one seeds. And I do want to talk about Kevin Love.
Yeah.
Really quickly. I think it's interesting. Whoa.
No, it's just, I want to hear what you say. It just, I'll tell you why I laughed at it.
I would like to say that LeBron carried that team down the stretch last year. And what we all kept saying was, oh, LeBron's carrying the team. His teammates are all hurt. Imagine if the Cavaliers were healthy, how much better they would be. Now they're healthy, and they're still trying to ship off Kevin Love. What say you about what's going on in Cleveland?
Well, that's why I laughed. It's like, what the hell is going on in Cleveland? I mean,
Tyronn Lue.
It's like, Kevin Love, go to the damn Bulls, bro. Go to the Bulls. That's the trade that needs to happen.
I would love
to have Kevin Love. Kevin Love and Jimmy Butler? Holy crap. I don't know why he doesn't fit. I don't know if it's a chemistry thing. I don't know what's happening in that locker room.
I think a lot of it is chemistry, actually.
It's got to be, because the guy was so good, and now, and he could have the same Dwight Howard type of thing where he wants to be the man, and if he's not the man, he's just like, eh. But then it's like, well, why did you go to Cleveland in the first place?
Because
you knew you weren't going to be the man.
Yeah, see, I don't think Kevin Love has the ego of, I thought I was going to be the man. I think that the Cavaliers were, I think it was fool's gold. It was LeBron's here, and, you know, we have this awesome coach coming from wherever he came from, right. David Blatt, and he's done X, Y, and Z in the European leagues. And I think it looked really good on paper. Like, that year, the Lakers had, was it Steve Nash and Dwight and Kobe? Like, they looked so good on paper, but then you put them on the court, and it kind of blew up in everyone's face. That's what happened, I think, with the Cavaliers, and Kevin Love has not fit into that system as graciously and as easily as he thought, and now it's time to peace out. I don't think it was an ego thing with him. I don't think he wants to be the man. Kevin Love knows no one's going to be the man underneath LeBron or playing alongside LeBron.
Yeah, and maybe it's just, you know, everybody talks about the big three. Sometimes it works. Obviously, sometimes it doesn't. It Mm-mm. worked in Miami. That was great.
And it worked in the Celtics, 08, 09.
Worked with the Celtics. It's, you know, it didn't really work in Oklahoma City. It kind of did, but maybe if Harden stays there, God, how scary could that team
been? That would have been. He would have been in a much better position, but that's neither here nor there at this point.
But, hey, Kevin Love, go to the Bulls. He's still young. I'll take a Kevin Love and Jimmy Butler squad and then build around that.
Okay. I will take Blake Griffin staying throughout the rest of the season, and I will the only piece I would like to give Blake up for is Kevin Durant next year. I don't even know if the salaries work that way for Katie to be able to come. I don't know, but that's my wish list. I would love Blake to stay throughout the season. If we ever got rid of him, trade up, and the only person I can think of trading up for that would help us would be for Kevin Durant.
I mean, that would be pretty nice.
That would be. Merry Christmas to Clipper Nation. Merry Christmas, Clipper Nation.
Merry Christmas.
Hashtag TMS Talk. NBA All-Star Weekend Recap. That was a little.
You've just been rapping all day.
I have been. You know, I actually am in a web series called Posers where I am a rapper.
That's right. Watch it. Posers.
Posers. It's not on yet, though.
Oh, it's not on YouTube or anything yet?
But we do have our teaser video called Cheat Day. It was a cheat day. So there you go.
Yeah, see? Okay. Is that on YouTube?
That is on YouTube.
Check it out.
Cheat Day parody.
Hashtag Posers.
That was just called, it's under Hot Mess Channel. Funny or Die actually featured it on their channel, too. Okay.
Boom.
I'm a rapper. Did you even watch the All-Star Weekend events, Trevor? No.
Not really.
I knew you were going to say no.
I watched YouTube highlights because it is just, I don't know. And I'm kind of bummed that I didn't watch the slam dunk contest.
You missed a good freaking show.
But here's my thing with the slam dunk contest. It's so long, and I don't like how it's formatted, because Gordon had the best dunk.
Hands down.
That dunk was just ridiculous.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he should win with that amazing dunk. But he had to use it early because you have to keep surviving.
Keep surviving, yeah.
And so I think the dunks, I think they start flatlining.
Well, see, for this particular dunk contest, last weekend's contest, I think that the dunks got better per dunk because Zach and Aaron were just trying, they were trying to out-dunk each other. As a matter of fact, the matchup between Zach and Aaron for the slam dunk contest peaked an average of 7 million viewers between 10:15 p.m. and 10:30. So as the dunks got better, the viewership went up. Also, I saw that there were 50,000 tweets per minute during the final round of the dunk contest. Ooh. So it was actually getting better. Now, this could be an anomaly because sometimes, like you said, the dunk contest can be slow and long. This was not one of those years. I thought that Aaron Gordon got robbed. What'd you say?
I agree.
You know, like both guys' dunks were just beyond athletic, amazing to watch. To watch these kids flying through the air like that was phenomenal. Aaron got robbed. Hashtag Aaron got robbed. That's what I think.
I also think the judges, and I get it, it's fun, but there kept being 50, 50, 50, 50.
Yeah.
It's like, God, somebody be a little bit harsher.
Well, that's what happened. So on the dunk that I think that Aaron should have won on, I think he got 2 or 3 9s. And that was not the time to give this young man a 9. Like, he deserved a 50 for that.
Bring in a Russian judge.
What would a Russian judge?
Don't you remember, like, in the Olympics, the Russian judge always screwed people?
Yeah.
So bring in one of, just bring in somebody totally harsh. That would be really funny, is actually if they brought somebody who was super conservative, had never seen a dunk before, and they were a judge.
That's a good idea, actually.
Because they'd be like, holy crap, what's going on?
That's a really good idea.
But I will say, Levine's dunk, where he did the Jordan but under his legs.
That was
pretty fantastic.
That's what sealed the deal for him. What sealed the deal. Okay, so you didn't watch any of the events. You watched stuff on YouTube.
Yeah.
I must admit, I did not see the 3-point skills challenge because I'm kind of over the Warriors. I don't need to see them shoot any more 3-pointers as long as I live. Okay. I also did not watch the skills challenge in general. And I really barely watched the game. And it makes me wonder, is the NBA All-Star game losing its luster the same way the NFL Pro Bowl is?
I think so. I think all of these All-Star games, I didn't watch the Pro Bowl, and I am a diehard football fan. Mm-hmm. I didn't watch All-Star Weekend. I didn't watch the Hockey All-Star Weekend. Mm. I will watch Major League Baseball's All-Star because
it matters.
Yes, yeah, there's something that these guys are playing for.
Yeah.
So they actually care.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, when the score is 196 to 173, it's like, that's kind of fun for a little bit, but then it just gets old. It's like the Pro Bowl. It's just score, yeah. Score, score. Nobody's doing it. Kobe, it made me laugh. One of his quotes is like, I hope these guys don't go, I hope they play hard against me and don't go easy. It's like, nobody's playing hard against anybody.
They're not, Kobe.
The game that I watched during that weekend, and I didn't this weekend, I just forgot about it. I was doing something. It's the celebrity game. I like that.
That's fun. That is fun, actually.
I like that game.
See, because you get to know, you feel like you're a little bit more intimate with your favorite celebrities.
And it's just goofy.
It is.
It's just kind of fun watching these guys because you're like, are these people actually athletic? Some of them are.
Some of them are athletes.
Some of them are pretty good. Yeah. Some of them aren't. Like, I remember when I was at a Super Bowl in Dallas on one of my breaks from a gig I was doing, I went and I watched the celebrity flag football game.
Oh, that's fun.
And that was a blast.
Yeah.
I was like, this is fun. This is fun to watch because it's kind of all over the place. But it was
kind of,
but it was entertaining.
Tell me how you feel about Kobe's farewell tour during the All-Star, or I guess it's all his farewell All-Star game. And I want to say this. A lot of people were saying that Kobe didn't deserve to be at the All-Star game because, you know, obvious reasons, he's not having an All-Star season. But personally, I respect Kobe's career. I respect what he's done not only for the Lakers organization, but for the game of basketball in general. And he is the closest that his generation will ever get to a Michael Jordan. So I have no problems with them. Well, I can't say giving him an All-Star place. He earned it. I mean, he earned it with his career and he earned it with the votes. So I don't know. I thought it was very sweet to watch him have his last NBA All-Star hurrah.
Yeah, and I agree with you. Usually I'm not a huge fan of, you know, these All-Star games where they just put in certain players because of who they are.
Mm-hmm.
But Kobe's different. I mean, this is his final. He's retiring.
20 years in the game.
20 years. He's one of the greatest ever. Easily top 10, if not top 5.
If not top 5.
I mean,
Kobe!
Kobe! And he did a little fadeaway. So that was, you know? And he's a Jordan light.
Yeah.
I mean, he's the closest that we'll ever see to a Jordan, most likely. I mean, they're all so similar.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So I thought it was cool. with the USA, I'm glad he didn't make that because that's a little different. But the All-Star game, I think it's cool when they bring these guys. It was like, you know,
it's cool when the grandpas get to play one last game.
Yeah, I mean, come on, let's celebrate these guys and the fact that we were fortunate enough to watch them play.
That's true.
And I can't wait till I'm 70 years old, sitting on my porch talking to my grandkids, and they're telling me who the hell knows going to be around then. I'll be like, no, Michael Jordan was the best ever. And they'll be like, Grandpa, you're so stupid. You've seen. I'm like, you don't know.
You'll never know. Hashtag TMS Talk, join the conversation on Twitter. Do you have a nasty stat for us today?
I do.
Trevor's nasty stat. This is Trevor's world. We're all just living in it.
108.
Okay, let me guess. I don't know. 108. 108. I don't know, but my sorority was founded in 1908.
Oh, okay. That was the last year the Cubs won the World Series.
Was it 08?
08. Okay. It's been 108 years.
Oh, that's your
that's
stat.
That's the nasty stat.
Okay, perfect. I'm excited. I mean, I'm not even excited about your stat. I'm excited. Okay, yes, I'm excited.
Yeah, well, hey, they go hand in hand. I do know. So that was my nasty stat. Now, this is just sad because 71. Oh.
What?
I just realized this nasty stat kind of correlates into our next topic.
Okay.
But 71 is the years since the Cubs have actually been to a World Series.
Dang, Cubs.
1945.
Dang, Cubs.
Right?
Oh, wow. My dad is born 1945.
That's a good year.
It is a good year. Well, not well for...
Well, it was the end of...
End of World War II.
Yeah, it was World... So there we go.
A long time ago.
A little history for you.
1908, 1945. And my nasty stat for you, Trevor, is whenever you say 1908, you say 1908.
1908? Is that 1-9?
1-9.
Were you guys in the same sorority?
are you an Alpha Jarvis? Oh! I did not know that. So Jarvis's fraternity.
Wait, do you have the brand? It didn't do the brand? My high school baseball coach was an Alpha.
Okay.
And he had the big brand. No.
He was a Q.
Excuse
me.
He was an Omega.
He was a Q, yeah.
He was an Omega, and he had the big brand on him. He was hilarious.
That is so funny.
God, coach.
Look at you.
I love that coach, man.
I love that coach,
too. He'd be dancing. He'd try to get us all to dance.
Oh, do his like, okay.
It was awesome. We tried to do it with him.
That was.
You know I was in it.
That was perfect, actually, Trevor. You're an honorary Q.
You know, I was there.
The Qs are stomping. Trevor's there.
Coach Ross was stomping. Trevor, little senior in high school, stomping with Coach Ross.
I'm going to let my friends know. Hashtag TMS Talk. That's funny. Hashtag 0608.
Right?
I go, that's, well, they're not. They're
I'm not supposed to do that. Well, right? Unless you're in the fraternity.
That's right, but it's okay.
Coach Ross let me do it. I'm honorary.
You are honorary. honorary NBA champs back-to-back could be the Warriors this year.
Look at that transition.
How about that segue?
That is a lot of hosting classes. You don't just transition like that, people.
You don't. Read a book.
Unless you're Bruce Jenner. Hey-oh!
Oh, Caitlin! Kisses to Caitlin, our regards. Will the Warriors break the 95-96 Chicago Bulls' best NBA all-time best 72-10 record? Michael Jordan, who obviously was on that team, has given the Warriors his blessing to break the record. He's like, dude, I'm smoking my cigars. I got some twin kids. I don't give up what y'all do.
Right.
And what second half losses do you predict the Warriors will have and predict their record too? I just asked a lot of questions, but
that's okay. I got them all.
Okay, go.
But first of all, I was a little disappointed in MJ. That guy's like the biggest competitor ever.
He doesn't mean it. He didn't mean that.
I know. I think maybe he was just being nice. Mm-hmm. Maybe like little reverse psychology.
I agree.
But I can't imagine that if the Warriors beat it, that he's not going to be pissed. You just know as a competitor, he's going to be like,
I think he'll be. I think he probably won't be giving him a standing ovation. But I think Michael Jordan is so great as an individual player, and the impact he had on the game transcends anything that we will see, at least for the next 5 to 10 years. He's like, cool, you can have that record. I'm Michael Jordan. I'm the GOAT. So I don't know. I mean,
yeah.
I don't think it was the most sincere statement, but because he has achieved so much on so many other levels. He owns a team. You know, he's basically a billionaire. He's like, dude, I'm cool.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know.
But I guarantee you he's watching.
Oh, God, yeah.
I know it. I know that man is watching. But going back to it, they will not.
They won't.
Beat the Bulls record. And here we go back to 71.
Okay.
From the years the Cubs have been to the World Series. And I'm going to say 71 will be the number of victories for our lovely Warriors.
So 71 and 11.
71 and 11. They're going to miss it. Well, they're going to miss breaking it by two, but they're going to miss tying it by one.
Okay.
And I just think down the stretch, they haven't suffered really any injuries. They've been super healthy.
They have been.
I think they've got a pretty brutal schedule down the stretch.
Mm-hmm. OKC, they play OKC two more times. They play San Antonio
twice
three times.
Twice in three games.
In three games.
Which is crazy.
And then San Antonio three times.
Clippers twice. Those Spurs games are in San Antonio both times.
And Clippers, they play the Clippers here, home, this weekend, I believe. Home for us, I think.
I forget, but they are playing the Clippers coming up.
Saturday.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's home or away, but
I should know, but I don't.
I know.
Okay.
I'm a Bulls fan. I don't know.
According to ESPN, they have a 36% chance to win 73 games, by the way.
That's actually not bad.
36% chance.
But they have 30 more games.
Okay.
Total. So can they go 25-5? We'll see. That actually it doesn't seem like it's that hard because they've gone 48-4 or whatever.
It doesn't.
But it's down the stretch. Will they rest some guys? They play Memphis, who's probably going to be battling twice in the final three games. I mean, they've got a rough schedule, so we'll see.
And I think with the Memphis thing, as with any Eastern team they play, like any competitive Eastern team that the Warriors play, those teams, like the Grizzlies, are going to be like on the playoff, not cusp because right now they're pretty secure 5 or 6, but they're going to be the kinds of teams who are playing hard, as hard as they can, to try to move up.
Yes.
A seed. And then the Eastern teams, you know, play much more defense than we play in the Western Conference. So they're going to be playing a different style of basketball that the Warriors don't have to play night in, night out, because Eastern Conference plays different kind of basketball. And also the Warriors have a little bit of a road trip coming up, so they could lose games on the ends of road trips where they're tired from traveling, tired from winning.
With that said, there is one game to watch out for.
Which is?
In my opinion, that's kind of a sleeper. It's at Atlanta.
Nice.
Because they play two road games, and then they have to, and I think they're on like the East, or they're on the West, and then they have to travel all the way to Atlanta.
To the ATL, shawty.
The ATL, watch out, because you know Atlanta, Eastern, they're going to be battling.
Yeah.
I mean, so we'll.
You know, I predict their record will be, I think they're going to tie it, Trevor. I think they're going to tie it. And I'm very nostalgic for the Bulls and for Michael Jordan. I mean, that's who I grew up loving. Like, that's who I grew up, you know, not can't say idolizing, but that's who I grew up really, really appreciating. And the thought of anyone or any team surpassing anything that the Bulls did in the 90s, or the thought of any one player holding a candle to Michael Jordan, is something that I'm not particularly too fond of. But I just don't see the Warriors losing 7 games at the second half of the season. I don't, because they don't have any injuries to note, and they shoot flawlessly. And it's not just Steph, it's not just Clay, it's everybody on the team can shoot from half court, it seems. And even when they're down 23, like they were to the Clippers, or they're down, you know, against, you know, an Eastern team, or, you know, they're battling against Phoenix, the Suns at the half, they still have such flawless shooting that it's like they're unbeatable. I'm almost with Popovich. Popovich says that he is never obsessed about a team so much the way he's obsessed about the Warriors, because how do you beat them?
Well, they're just frustrating, because you can play amazing defense. You've got Steph like at that. God, I can't. It's at center court.
Yeah.
And there's 2 seconds on the shot, and he fires it up, and boom.
Yeah.
Swish. You're like, what do we have to do to stop these guys? And it's crazy that they have been so good this season that we're saying that it's going to be hard for them to go 23-7. Like 23-7, that's great. Every other team in the NBA would be like, if I finish on a 23-7 run, that's insane. We're like, I don't see them losing seven games. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. So they're 48-4 right now, right? Yeah, 48-4. So yeah, I think they're gonna tie the record. I think it's gonna be a 72-10 season for the Warriors. And okay, what do you say? Let's write this down.
I'm going 71-11.
Trevor.
Just because I'm holding on to the Bulls of the 90s because the Bulls of the 2000s has not been very pretty. And damn, just think if Michael decided not to go play minor league baseball, they could have been the only team ever to win in a decade.
Ooh,
they could have won from
true.
91 to 99.
They could have.
Oh, that would have been awesome. But it didn't happen, obviously.
Hashtag TMS talk, Michael Jordan. Why did you go play minor league baseball?
Why?
He had to, though, because he and his dad, that was one of their things. So, you know.
Well, he came back and dominated. Okay. That's how good he was.
He was awesome.
That's just stupid. I'm going to take a year and a half off, go play baseball, come back, and we're going to crush people.
Mm-hmm. I like it. That's how we did it in the 90s, you young people. That's how shit went down in the 90s, before the internet.
Truth. Hashtag truth.
Hashtag truth. Best and worst of them is making an appearance or a comeback. We used to do this back in the day, but we kind of got away from it because we just talked so much. But now we're going to do best and worst of. We're going to start off with the 58th edition of the Grammys. And we're going to do a hot potato, hot seat style. And what we used to do for best and worst of, we'll just go back and forth and say, oh, this is what I think is what I think. But today we're going to say, this is what I think, but you have a minute. Each of us is going to pass the football. This is the proverbial hot potato. Mm-hmm. Pass the football. And each time you catch the potato, you have to say either a best moment or a worst moment from the 58th Grammys. And Jarvis is going to time it for us. Jarvis is going to time it for us. This is perfect. So, yeah, we have a minute. Not a minute each. A minute total. You can tell us when to go, Jarvis. Okay, guys, okay. Best moment from the 50th Grammys, Kendrick Lamar's performance of We Gonna Be All Right, Blacker Than Berry, was moving, relevant, provocative, and was best performance of the night.
Best moment of the night, Kanye West, Nowhere to Be Found.
Ooh, I like it. Worst, Adele's performance of All I Ask. That's my favorite song off the album, but the sound was so bad, it made her look bad.
Yeah, what the hell is up? You're the Grammys. How do you have bad sound people?
It's bad. Best, Taylor Swift, back to Kanye, shading Kanye West in her acceptance speech, saying, I'm the only second woman in the world to ever get best of album 2 years in a row or two different years. Oops, I messed that up.
just going along with Taylor Swift, eat some In-N-Out burger, double-double, animal style, for the love of God, Taylor Swift.
Oh, for the love of God, worse, Sofia Vergara. What the hell was she doing on stage with Pitbull? I'm like, this is like, I'm sorry. Like, you were not getting your groove back, Sofia. Take your groove backstage.
Worst, the fact that the Grammys only have 8 categories that they announce during the Grammys. Oh, that worked out perfect.
That was good. We are so proud of ourselves. Give us a round of applause. Thank you. Best and worst of Peyton Manning might be in some hot water, adding a new page to the book of Manning.
It's okay. This whole story is so crazy because this guy, Sean King, first of all, how does he work for the New York Daily News? Like, that's when you uncover this guy's history, he is all over the board.
Yes.
He became famous on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Just throwing out all sorts of craziness.
He's a social activist, and yes, you're right. He's used social media, Twitter mostly,
yes,
to build his platform.
And for most of it, from what I've heard and read, a lot of it's bullshit. Like he makes up stuff just to kind of rile people up.
He's a polarizing figure. He is. I do understand what you're saying about some of Sean King's statements being sometimes unwarranted. So I cannot disagree with that. But is Sean the person who renamed Peyton in this Title IX suit with Tennessee? Is he the reason that Peyton's name came up again?
I think so. I mean, I don't even know why this.
Why they're talking.
Why he wrote an article. This happened 20 years ago. Got settled 13 years ago, and all of a sudden it's coming back. It's like, because this guy had nothing to write about, but so now he wants to bash Peyton Manning for something he did 20 years ago as a 19-year-old kid, which I'm not condoning by any stretch, but I can see a dumb 19-year-old do something like that and be like, holy shit, that was the dumbest thing ever. But I can see it.
So if you guys out there aren't following the Peyton Manning story, allegedly in 1996 when he was a quarterback at the University of Tennessee, he put his balls on a he puts his balls on a female trainer's neck or chin or something.
It was like her head. So
or her head.
I don't know if you could see me, but apparently from what I know, he was like sitting on the trainer's table. She was checking out his ankle.
His ankle.
And while she wasn't looking, he like pulled down his pants and he like did one of these.
Okay.
And he like sat on her. Like, okay. Pseudo sat on her.
Okay.
Which, God, is a terrible thing to do, but I can see a 19-year-old.
I can see that too.
Dude, just being like, oh, this is funny.
And there's a women's group who just today has asked for nationwide Papa John's and other companies who have Peyton Manning as a spokesperson to pull their ads because. Essentially, this is a sexual assault. Essentially, like if you really want to be just completely, just strict about what the actual incident was, it was a sexual assault. And they settled. Right. I think she got a $300,000 settlement back in the 90s. And then they were supposed to not speak about it again, but they did in 2003 when they put it in, when he and his dad wrote about it in their book. But long story short, it's very unfortunate this has resurfaced. I really seriously doubt that Peyton Manning has, for the extent of his career, gone about putting his balls on people's necks. And I think this, like you say, was a 19-year-old stupid college, you know, frat boy kind of mistake. And let's move on.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, it's a non-story that's become a story. And the more that I'm hearing and learning about it, this woman also, like, kept contradicting her story.
Mm.
So some lawyer came on, I think it was like ESPN Radio, and they're like, if they actually would have gone to court, she probably would have lost and got nothing. So I think, I don't know exactly what happened in there.
We don't know.
Only three people know.
And who's the third person?
There was a teammate.
Oh, yeah, the teammate supported, Peyton's story, you're right.
And he was contradicting his story, too, so it's like, well, somebody just tell the truth, but it happened 20 years ago. It's been settled. It's a terrible thing. I'm sure Peyton Manning obviously regrets it.
Yeah.
Probably regretted it right after. It was a major story in Tennessee for years. And so now to resurface it, it's like, come on.
Come on, man. Just to you young players out there, no putting your balls on anybody's necks unless it's consensual. Okay.
I think my chair got lower.
It did.
Hey, everybody.
Guys, we actually got through all of our topics today. What in the hell is going on? While Trevor fixes his chair, I'm Erica Renee Davis. You can find me on Snapchat, Periscope, Twitter, Instagram, and on YouTube at Erica Renee D.
Yes. And next week?
Yes.
Not next week, 2 weeks from now. We're so close to March Madness.
Oh, yes. I cannot wait to talk college basketball.
It's going to be an amazing episode, and I'm going to pat myself on the back.
Four.
And this is so old news, but
what?
I picked the Broncos to beat the Panthers.
Did you?
And I picked their score.
Well, you did not pick the Broncos.
I picked the Broncos, and I said they would score 24 points.
But you picked the Panthers to win.
No.
Yes, you did, Trevor.
No, we're going to go back to the tape. We're going to pull the tape. I'm Trevor Anthony. Find me on Twitter at Trevor Anthony. Also find me on Vine and definitely follow the Morning Score so that you could see that I did pick
the Morning Score on Twitter at the Morning Score, the Morning Score on Instagram at the Morning Score Show, the Morning Score on YouTube. Make sure you share this iTunes, YouTube, TuneIn, Stitcher. Until next time.
Don't go putting your balls on anybody's chin.
What he said. See ya.
To get down, I'm not internationally known, but I'm known to rock the microphone because I get stupid. I mean outrageous. Stay away from me if you're contagious.